Okay, it is Friday. Why are you doing the Carlton right now, Laiya?
I don't know.
Thank you.
She's excited for news.
Hey, man, it's another week and we're still here. Yay.
Yeah.
Roll call.
Boy, this week has been exhausting as fuck. But
yo,
yeah, man, I was going to ask
you. Rick Rubin.
Turn that shit down. We got to
turn down the thing now, son.
Yeah. Okay. And so, you were expecting a nice fade, right?
No, nah, I like the hard cut.
Yeah, we need a hard cut this week.
Hard cut. Nah, I was gonna say, yeah, Amir, you look like really stressed, man. You look really like kind of stressed to me. Like, has it been a heavy week for you?
It's been a super heavy week. Let's see. You know, first the whole cancel culture thing was a little bit entertaining.
Okay.
Then that shit started hitting close to home rapidly. But then at the end of the day, it's like, with the George Floyd situation, I mean, you know, it's everything, but even then I feel like even me ranting down a list of these things almost borderline feels like first world problems. Cause I'm personally safe. However,
no, you ain't very, though.
It's very hard not to internalize none of this shit. You know what I mean?
And
just with
real,
the daily
Amir,
and with just the regular daily rigmarole of, you know, mom, hey, you fine? Is blah 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 supermarket able to deliver? No.
Yeah, because like, let's not forget, in the midst of all these police shootings, there's still a whole ass pandemic going on.
Exactly. Exactly. So
that's still a thing.
And how immune are you when you a black man out in farm town right now? Everybody don't know who Questlove is, so let the sun go down a little too dark and you be walking down the street. Ain't that much difference?
I don't go out. I mean, I go out for, I do my morning walk. I mean, Grace would prefer I do it at 6 a.m.
But time doesn't even matter when it comes to getting shot these days. So.
I'm more like 9 a.m. I had one situation where I went on my own and I was walking in the park and I got a, are you lost? But
wow.
But this, yo, this.
Was
this
it
happens,
a kind?
This happens. Oh, and it almost, the lost, thing is that I.
Did that to Amir
white
out front
Phonte,
of Rockefeller
white people.
Yeah, yeah, the thing
who,
is that
I mean, yeah,
that
who the fuck gets
to
lost in 2020?
Wow.
Exactly. This Google shit back. Happens to me all the time, but I think I always compare my thing to like, well, you know, people are, motherfuckers are dying over this shit, so I never share the massive amounts of, you know, and it's not harassment in comparison, but it's still the same trauma. You still get the same trauma when, I mean, I've had police officers walk on me like, yo, man, my first root show was, you know, back in college, man. It was my favorite thing ever. I mean, it'll be brothers, but it's still something traumatizing that just triggers off with me.
Because you're still a damn police.
When I see that, yeah. So it's still, you know, but, dude, man.
It was a lot. I think it was just the back. Like it was, you know, it was Ahmaud Arbery. Then it was, Chris Cooper. Then it was your girl, Breonna
Taylor.
I was like, man, right. I'm forgetting last name. Breonna Taylor. So, yeah, it's just been a lot of things back to back on top of, you know,
a pandemic.
COVID, pandemic. Just on top of the pandemic and everything else. I think at the end of the day, and, you know, you still got to answer. You still got to add on the Charlemagne.
Joe Biden. That was
We forgot about that.
Forget about Joe Budden. Never forget Joe Budden. Never forget Joe Budden. For real, that is a shirt.
Yeah, I think, yo. But so I think with him, with Biden, it's, you know, we kind of caught in a bad place because no one, and I have to talk to my political friends about this, nobody is excited about voting for this motherfucker, right? Like, we're not excited about
it. Lesser of two evils.
Absolutely. But
is it lesser than Hillary? Because they was real upset about Hillary. So now is it like, is it?
He could raise some I'll be honest with you. If he chooses I'm having a brain fart right now, y'all. I literally just got in the house.
Stacey Abrams.
Stacey.
If he chooses Stacey Abrams, that could light my fire. I mean, the whole point is that I do not and cannot handle another 4 years of this shit.
Bro.
And so, yeah. Yes, I'm
I don't think the country can take 4 years. I don't think we can survive.
And I feel like it's harder. It's going to be harder doing the campaigning thing because, again, it's like everyone's seeing this as the lesser two evils. You got the Bernie bros that are sort of like not excited.
I don't care. If they don't vote, I'm coming to their house. I'm tired of these Bernie people.
Yeah, I'm tired of them.
I'm not playing with y'all this year.
Like he didn't win, y'all. Sorry,
and if Bernie get in line. I'm sorry. I ask a question? Can I just hear from the white men? Because it's been a long week for us. How has it been for you guys?
Joe Budden for president.
Okay. Steve, how about you?
I moved today.
Wait, you moved?
So these are your problems, huh? That's beautiful.
Laiya just trying to put us on the spot because we're white.
No, I'm trying to put you about on the spot because you're in this conversation and we are
I'm actually this is one diversion I do like. Wait, you moved?
Yeah. Upstairs.
Yeah, I just moved to a different apartment in the same building.
Okay.
You're gonna stay in New York.
No, man. I mean, it's a wait and see situation when you're, you know.
You don't think it's time to head up north with your family?
I do, but I didn't really have a choice. My lease came up at an unfortunate time, and I had to make a decision based on uncertainty.
Can I ask you something? Because I too, for the first time in my life, like bartered my situation. That quote I used for. Oh, the other drama of the Instagram DJing thing.
Oh, man.
Where,
did you see that ad they made? That fucking ad with the dog and the... I was like, nigga, y'all know who y'all going for with this. Get the fuck out of here, dude. Ain't none of these niggas made Instagram Live hot. Y'all know who made this shit hot. Get the fuck out of here.
Right, yeah, I was a little... perturbed over that. And actually this morning we had a rather sizable meeting of which it's still going on what we're going to do because we got to move as a team
with Instagram or meeting with your the roots.
Oh, with us, like we realize the power is with us because the thing is that in quote not in the real world, in the old world, I'll say that the DJs were the DJs that were in the seven figure zone, most of them are kind of handicapped now because without the lights and the special effects and the pointing and the jumping and all that stuff.
Party every 30 seconds.
Yeah, they're kind of struggling right now. So, the ones that are pulling the big numbers are not surprisingly, but the ones that are more creative with their presentation. So we are weighing our options, and there's an even bigger factor of should we, because the thing is that this rare chance of a ground zero for everything, the environment, our political situation.
This is our chance to rewrite everything.
Yeah, this is like the refresh button.
I was asking Steve and Bill the same question because it should not be.
Wait, let me get the point out.
With the three of us.
My whole point. Well, can you not interrupt me? My whole point is that, I brought up the thing, why don't we start our own joint? Why don't we start our own play? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so we're talking. So I don't want to put.
Say no more.
We're weighing all of our options. Anyway.
Yvonne is on hold, so we can't continue the conversation that I've been trying to have. But congratulations on having that light bulb moment that we should start our own shit. Like,
thank you. Let's ladies and gentlemen, actually, dude, I am so in love with this HBO special she's about to release.
It's, she killed that shit. I wasn't ready.
Yes,
I know. Yvonne, you know what? All right, you've been in my phone for like a year now. Like now I really want you, I want to be your best friend. I cannot love
excellent
that
show.
HBO special anymore than like seriously, I've not loved something that much since probably maybe Bring the Pain.
Back how about to say Chris Rock?
You better stop.
No, I'm like I feel like I really know you now. Like,
and I appreciate your Eddie Murphy remix on the leathers. I see you, girl.
You know, you gotta kiss to the grace. You gotta be like, okay, it can't just be a jumpsuit, but I am gonna have some leather. You know, I'm gonna get my Xena Warrior Princess on. You know what I mean? Hey, homie.
Well, I didn't even officially make the introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Yvonne Orji to Questlove Supreme live on Friday.
Thank you
so much.
Her whole.
What's going on? First of all, I want these earrings. I mean, it will go with my outfit right now.
Oh. Do you hear that,
isn't
fellas?
Isn't that Bill's favorite pair of earrings?
Yes, it is.
Bill's, I love those earrings.
Hideous things ever.
When all my jeans went to shit, I cut them into shreds and I put them on hoops. And those are your earrings. And they look wonderful.
Wait, who made them, Jordan's, like?
A black woman.
A black woman.
You don't know her name, do you?
So I'm joking. I got it from the Stable Collective in DC. It is a black owned boutique. I was just cutting to the chase, and it takes a DMV girl to appreciate him. So I appreciate.
I was about to say DMV
all day.
You about to have a real good time. Okay.
Yeah,
this should be called the Laiya Yvonne Show.
I'm gonna just sit back, let y'all go.
Yeah, just watch it happen.
Yvonne, I was gonna say I watched her, like me and my wife, we watched it just blind. I never even seen the like the trailer for it.
Yeah, so I knew.
We just put it on and I was like. Yeah, we ain't know nothing. We was like, all right, let's see what it is. And I was telling all my homies, I haven't seen a comedian work and be clean that effectively since Sinbad.
Wow, I forgot she was clean.
Oh, shit, I forgot.
Yeah, like you don't even notice it. Because some clean, you know, it's like clean musicians or clean comedians, they try to make that the thing. Like, well, I'm working clean. It's like, but nigga, that shit ain't funny. But she doesn't make it a part of what I felt. You know what I mean? Like, you didn't make it a part of the draw. Like, yeah, it's not a weapon. Like, look, I'm clean. Laugh at me. It was like, that shit was really fucking funny. And the way you, without giving too much away, because I don't want to spoil, but the way, like, you kind of tell the joke, and then you go, and they go to Nigeria. Yeah, the interstitials to kind of explain where the joke came from. Like, I thought that was really dope. So, nah, just big salute. That shit is fucking dope.
I really appreciate that. No, it was when I told HBO, I was like, if we're going to do a special, we're going home? And they were like, turn up. And I was like, oh, we don't even have to argue about this. I have to pitch this. They were like, have we ever gone to Nigeria? No. So we're going to Nigeria. And that's the thing with HBO. It's like, they're like, yeah, let's do what hasn't been done. And so that we can be like, we did it. And I was like,
that is dope.
Let's go. Thank you guys. Y'all make me feel, my publicist has just showed me that my billboards are up. So I'm a little emotional today because I'm like, yo, I know. Because, you know, it's quarantine, so I wasn't sure if it was still going to happen. Like, ain't nobody on the road. But she was just like, you on, you know, Hollywood Boulevard right now. And I'm like, and so I'm.
Yo, and what you did for DC, like taping that comedy special in Howard Theater?
Howard Theater,
I didn't even know. It's funny. I didn't.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say I didn't even know do my research to know that you are a DMV Nigerian girl. Are you Igbo too?
I am Igbo. Hey, Auntie, how far? Where can they have food? We never this place.
What's can someone up? Help me, Bill and Steve, and maybe Phonte?
And Phonte, yeah.
I know it's going.
Oh, break it down, Yvonne.
Well, no, because I DM, so my mom was a nurse at Howard University, like I said, in the special for 27 years. And when we moved from Nigeria, we lived first in Calverton, Maryland, and then we moved to Laurel, and which is where, you know, we stayed. And, you know, so many other people had done, like, DAR, Constitution Hall. They've done, like, a lot of the major...
They don't even like us.
They've done a lot of the major places. And Howard Theater, I don't think they had done a comedy special since they, you know,
refurbished it, yeah.
Exactly. So for me, you know, and I there's a part of me that wanted to do something in PG County, but I was like, I was like, I'm gonna honor my mom. It's called Why My Maiden. And I'm honor my mom in this way, but also I spent so much time waiting at the lobby of Howard University Hospital on the quad. My two brothers went there. I was like, low key, I'm an honorary bison anyway. Let's just
I went to high school across the street. I say the same thing.
Yeah. I mean, all my GW folks, I paid all my bills. So yeah, my degree still came. Yeah, so
it's like a tennis match.
Auto pay.
You know what I'm saying?
Auto pay.
Listen, that was that was not an even joke. That was real life. I was like, nah.
No, that is real life. Auto pay is a success symbol. Auto pay is a success symbol. When you just pay some shit blindly, nigga, you made it.
What's crazy is because I did a tour before I shot the special. And like, it's funny because all the black people in the audience was like, my nigga. And for the white people, like, auto pay. So this is why it's important for us. Cause I'm like, y'all ain't spending money. Y'all just out here just paying your bills whenever it comes out your account.
Right.
I was going to ask you, I'm always curious about the journey that leads up to the final special. Mm-hmm. Where do you work out your material, and how long did that process take you to get there?
You know what's funny is like I'm high key and unorthodox comedian in the sense that when I was starting out, one, I didn't know that there was like comedy clubs. Like this is it, because I started in DC, right? And so there are not a lot of comedy clubs. But because I'm Nigerian, what I ended up doing was hosting a lot of weddings. Anything that had a function, I hosted a baby shower, I hosted a funeral, I hosted, yes, I was the ultimate hype.
How do you host a funeral?
He's dearly departed, but we don't celebrate his life. You're like, nigga, which means how you host a funeral? You turn up. Dear life chief of Umuduru, but we thank God for his life. Everybody, he be me. You know, you make it a party. Okay.
Wait a minute. I'm sorry. Wait, are any of you guys familiar with the meme?
The meme with homie doing the
dead
meme
with the, yeah, the, yeah. That's all I'm thinking about. But it's a Nigerian funeral. So you turn up.
So exactly. So it was like when I couldn't get on the main stages, because again, it's like I didn't really know anybody, and it's not like I had a lot of connections, and I didn't even know if this was a real reality coming from immigrant parents. So I just honed my craft whenever I got in public with a mic. Then when I moved to New York, that's when I was like, what the hell are burner shows? I ain't bring nobody but myself. I gotta have five friends. I don't have that many friends. Like, it was just like all these roadblocks. And I was like, and so then I took over an open mic, which is called My Mind Made It. And so I called it My Mind Made It. Because the hope was like, man, one day maybe somebody from Fallon or, you know, Tenacia will come see me perform. You know, I'm in New York, anything could happen. So I was like, you couldn't tell me nothing that, like, you couldn't tell me I was gonna make it, because I was like, not making it means I go back to Lower Maryland where dreams go to die. No offense. Mm. I love people. Ain't nobody like in Lower Maryland on on the come up. So I was just like, the goal is to get out and rep hard. Not stay in.
So can you talk about from 2 degrees? Because you said you got 2 degrees, right?
Yeah.
Correct?
I have a master's in public health.
So how do you get from there, and explain it like you explained it to your parents, how I'm get from here to I'm going to go out and make people laugh?
You're going to prostitute yourself.
Yeah, and that was a nice version. That was the kind, like, you want to prostitute. That was the kind version. My parents said some other things. There were some other words.
A little bit more convincing in real life, right, Yvonne?
So how do I get there? So when I got my bachelor's from GW, my parents, that, like, at the graduation party, everybody that was there was Nigerian. So when are you going to medical school? And I had already known. Like, it was my bad, because sophomore year when I got that F in organic chemistry, I was like, the devil is a lie. I can't even do these covalent bonds. What the hell is this? Like, I knew then, but I was lying to myself and lying to my parents. So I just was like, maybe after I graduate, they'll get off my back. Nope, they did not. So they were like, is it, or when you will study for the MCAT? And I was like, you know what? I really want to get my master's in public health. And that was my way of stalling. Like getting another degree was my way of stalling from getting another degree. How many years was that?
Gap year.
It was a 2.5 year program. So I graduated 2015 and then 2018. And then I did the cheat code. I worked at GW so they could pay for the master's.
Yes.
And I was doing the most.
Yeah, that's the Nigerian gap year, Bill. That's. I was like, yeah, that's the Nigerian remix.
The Nigerian gap. Yeah,
it's not a gap thing. At all. Like, it's just years. It's not a gap at all. Mm-hmm. You know? And so after I got my master's, then my parents, like, legit, this is a real life. They were like, and so now, and I was like, you know, Liberia just finished the Civil War. I think I should go in the middle of, you know, a war zone because that was easier than telling them I didn't want to go to med school. I put myself in a battleground so I could be like, you know, I should apply my public health degree in a real-time situation. And they were like, what? And so I went to Liberia. I promise you, I went to Liberia in 2008, like right before Obama got elected. So this was November. And then when I got back, it was a recession because it's now 2009. Right. Nobody else had a job, and I was like, nigga, I got it. This is my decoy. Like, I can tell my parents officially that I want to do comedy because everybody else is poor. You know, because that's the thing. It's like, everybody else broke. Nobody else has a job. But how I even got to comedy was God. It was literally, and Holy Spirit himself was like, do comedy. And I was like, nah, nigga. I was like, we're not doing that. And I was like, and I, you know, sorry, God, but I was like, no.
Nah, he cool.
I was like, we good on that. Yeah. And he was just like, well, what else do you have? And I was like, how am I supposed to tell my parents God told me to do comedy? And I definitely did. I was like, you know what? But it's God, though. Who can argue with God? And so I told my parents, I was like, you know, God told me. They were like, God. So before you were born, who was praying to God first? I was like, nigga, you're not even going to accept God. You can't.
Inadmissible.
I couldn't even use the God part on them. They were like, so well, we're not praying to God before you are born. I was like, well, I don't know how effective those prayers were. So that's how we got here.
I'm baffled because this is absolutely unprecedented. And I will say almost similar to the path that you created, Phonte, being part of the first generation of rappers doing the blog era online. Because the thing is that for the last 10 years, even though I haven't written about them or did like in-depth studying to that I did of chefs, I've always kept my eyes on comedians, and especially being in New York, I was told that there's a very specific step A through step Z that you have to go through in order to get these results. And anyone else that doesn't do these particular steps is cheating the bank line on a Friday, and the results are normally that you're not that funny. And I'm obsessed with comedians only because I'm curious at watching the seed of a joke sprout into a full-blown forest of it. And like, you did everything so seasoned, so with so much confidence, it was almost like, how did you keep this secret?
From the moment you came out, yeah.
How did you keep this secret from your parents? Because even, like, there's so many parallels that I saw in my life and your performance that, you know, I mean, I joke all the time that, it's not joke, it's real. Like, I had to wait until deep in my career to tell my dad I'm a musician. He found out on my second album. I'd somehow miraculously let the first album by. He knew nothing about the roots. And then my cousin's like, because Amir's in the Sunday paper. So then it's like, I got to explain that I'm not going to college and I'm not like selling insurance to do all, you know, the things that your parents want you to do. So to how long, like, what was the first moment where you were just like, man, I'm going to do this shit? Like,
So I've been at this since 2006, right? So when I did the pageant, which is where I first performed, at first I was like, this is just a fluke, because it was like the Miss Nigeria in America pageant. I was like, well, this is very specific. There's a whole bunch of Nigerian, you know.
There's like, such a thing?
There was in 2006. It
don't exist. Probably in D.C.
Was it one of those... Which one of the pageants was it that like a white woman won? What was it?
Black America? Maybe you're talking about Miss Black America.
It wasn't Black. I hope it wasn't Black America.
Oh my god!
I feel like it was. I saw it online. It was one of those. Yo, you it was like an African country. Right. It wasn't Black America, but it was one of them. A white woman won. I don't know if it was Miss Nigerian, but that shit was hilarious.
It was it
probably South Africa.
It might have been. It might have been.
So I did that, and then I was like, all right, God, maybe he just threw me an alley-oop one right, you know, real quick. This is not a real thing. And then the next competition I entered was DC's Funniest College Student. So I was like, okay, well, let's see. And I ended up winning for GW. So they took every college, so they took two winners from every college, and the prize was that you got to perform in DC improv. So then it was like me and 15 other guys, because I was the only girl. I was like, well, ain't this about, okay? And I remember getting off the stage, and it was an Asian dude and an Indian dude that was like, yo, your jokes remind me of my mom, just with a different accent. And then I think that was the first time I was like, maybe there's something here. Maybe there's a subgroup of people that I can really speak to, even if everybody else don't get my jokes.
I was worried about that, because I was like, as a DC girl that know, like, of course, Nigerians are one of the biggest populations are in DC. Mm-hmm. And I was like, man, I get every one of these jokes, but I was like, is everybody going to get this? Or are you going to be cool with the fact that you don't know what she's talking about, but it's funny as fuck? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I got it.
You want to know why?
Why?
And I hate to say the C word. I hate to say the C word.
Color,
but she's choosing that Cosby route. Family is so, it's like, we forgot about that. I could have said the F word.
About that. Like, I'm about to C word. What, nigga? COVID?
Like, oh, damn. No, there's so many C words.
Yo. You said it so high. I was like, colorism?
You can't be bringing that into conversation.
No, it's related. Dude, it's relatable. And I my hope is that this expands out of, I feel like this is even going to break boundaries with all types. So, sort of in the same way, have you ever seen Russell Peters do stand-up?
Yeah.
Exactly, Laiya. Russell Peters is a comedian who probably couldn't get arrested on the streets, but can sell out Madison Square Garden.
Yeah. I know her. Wow. Yeah.
Sells out Madison Square Garden like 9 nights in a row.
Yeah, real talk.
Like, he has the entire Asian community on lockdown. And he's like a hip-hop head. Like, Russell Peters is the type of dude that when he last came to Fallon, I lie to you not, this was his entourage. Imagine, okay, you remember that song in Kill Bill when they're walking in slow motion with the Led Zeppelin drums,
mm-hmm.
like real slow, like we're coming to kill shit. Imagine Russell Peters and then like Melly Mel in an all red Eddie Murphy suit, like Kangol from UTFO,
so many
one
things.
Of the dudes from Whistle.
God. Now I gotta go to his Instagram. That's
like Sherrick from like Call In Your Name. Like, he is a very
Who wasn't there?
Like the youngest dude in his entourage was like there. Special Ed. Like Cash Money is his DJ. DJ Cash Money. But
Money is his DJ?
Dude, remember when Cash Money retired from DJing?
Wow. Okay.
He was fuck that. You're my inspiration. He's a hip hop. He's probably the only dude that's not a DJ that goes to Jazzy Jeff's playlist.
Wow.
Like, he's just a hip hop head, but his whole entourage is nothing but like, it'll be like not even like Bowlegged Lou. It'd be like a member of, like Shy Shy.
Kurt with three thieves. That nigga's name was Kurt.
No, but I feel like this is the spark of something big. Like by this time next year, you shouldn't be returning none of my texts.
You're gonna be a whole
season mixtape potluck. Oh my god, I'm gonna pimp that out. Like,
but Yvonne, new phone, who this?
What do you? It's interesting though, because it's like your life is kind of gone opposite of some people in a way, right? In a sense that you are already on a hit show,
nice one,
special. So like, what else? And you've already done some movies. So what do you want? What do you want next after?
And I'm a Nigerian woman. I want everything. I'm like, but just going back before that, it's like to the point of what you guys were saying in terms of like what this opens up. Mm-hmm. As a woman, as a Black woman, and then as an African woman, I'm not supposed to do this, you know, on so many levels. Like I'm not supposed to, you know, if you're so boisterous and if you're so loud and if you're that person, it's like, who am I to you? You know, just make sure, just stand by yourself, you know? And it's, and then it's like, you still see comedy. I mean, I say it all the time in every interview. I'm like, some more for me should have popped in such an amazing way.
That part.
Like, some more was, I grew up like watching Def Comedy Jam. I grew up watching her and being like, wow, she's really like very specific. And I admire her. And it's just like, there's, mainstream puts it like, unless you are X, Y, and Z as a Black female comedian, you're probably not gonna make it. Cause if you're not overweight, then you know, are you really funny? It's like, what the hell? So it's like, you know, if you look pretty and you're skinny, it's like, well, the jokes are gonna be subpar. That's not, I don't agree with that. Or you have to like speak very like, you have to speak politically. Then you have the Wanda Sykes, who's amazing and is clever and brilliant. Wanda's building an empire. But then it's just like, for me, I think when people see Black, they see like a monolith. And I'm glad that I'm able to be like, I am Black and being able to show like, no, there's subcultures of Blackness that are all relevant and we have different experiences that we can all talk about. And so it's kind of like, as even when editing the special, I didn't realize it, but as I was watching it back, it was like, it's almost like a 30-30 split of like African, like very African stuff and then very American stuff. And then it's just like, y'all figure it out. Like, cause I'm not gonna explain, dumb down, I'm not gonna water it down. It's like, I'm both and here.
And yeah, I didn't get that vibe at all. Like when I watched it, like to Laiya's question, like the question of how, if you're not Nigerian, you know, how do you get it? To me, it was very much, it reminded me a lot of country people, you know what I mean? Country folk. Like if you grew up, I mean, I grew up in the South, like born, raised, still here. And the part, without spoiling anything, the part where you do the joke about, the bit about, you know, the directions, right? Mm-hmm. When you went back and went to Nigeria and dude, that was my hometown. Like as a kid, like back before, you know, apps and GPS saved us, asking somebody how to get somewhere. Oh my God, what?
Rush around and rush it off, yes.
So I think it was, to me, what I felt was just the spirit of what you were saying. Even if you don't know Nigerian people, you know those kind of people.
It's the universality of it. We're more alike than we are different. We try to make ourselves different. And it's just like, we all have to come from somewhere, y'all. Mm. And it's just like, if you ever had a parent, I don't care, there's so many Americans, like of all races who are like, yeah, no, I told my mama I wanted to be a writer. And she was like, what the heck are you talking about? Because everybody in your family went to do pre-law, and it's like, but I don't want to. So it's just like, you can relate to it in a certain way. You can relate to it in the way of like, man, we did it. we made it. But what do I want to do next? I have my book coming out next year, Bamboozled by Jesus, How God Tricked Me into the Life of My Dreams.
Nice. I love the title.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so that's just my way of like parallel. It's funny because like, you know, people ask like, how are you able to like be like fully Christian, you know, in Hollywood? And I was like, I didn't I didn't know I couldn't be. I didn't know I had to hide that. I didn't know that was a choice. Like, you know, it's kind of like, I didn't know I could not be a thing that makes me me.
Well, yeah, I guess they mean be truly Christian and follow all the rules, because a lot of people call themselves Christians, but they don't follow all the rules. And Yvonne,
yeah, as my grandma was saying,
all the rules.
Nah, because as my grandma would say, we holy from the waist up.
Yvonne, not so much. It's like,
grandma, no, that's real.
That's another one, hey, for bro. You, Bill.
Wait, okay,
my grandma's a G, cuz.
I'm going to write that down and use it never. So that's great.
Yeah, so how do you...
That didn't change, right? Y'all don't even hear me talking to Yvonne.
No, I hear it. I'm with you. Because like, you didn't talk about that in the special, which I thought was great. Right. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, your virginity, is that still a thing? Is that, like, where are you at in your walk with that?
I don't necessarily talk about it, because I don't put any extra sauce on it. It is what it is. Right. It's kind of like, niggas not walking around and be like, yo, you know what I had yesterday? A thruple. Nigga, like, good luck. Like, you don't even know nobody's walking around that, like, guess what a nigga did, though? It's like... Okay, right. So I'm not like, guess what a nigga didn't do, though. It's like,
but you know, you the only virgin that we see on TV and be like, but eat my ass, though. So that be the, you know.
What a transition.
Yeah. Good segue, Laiya, yet
I
again.
I think right. That is the clip.
Good. It was such That's a good episode last night.
For the Yvonne Orji episode. So, Questlove Supreme, live on Friday, y'all. Join us.
Amir, you didn't see last week's episode, did you?
Yeah, thank you for that. No, I'm still catching up. I'm like three behind.
It's okay. I know he ordered. You can be like catching up.
I think God has a sense of humor. I think the fact that my last name is Orji,
that part.
How is it for your parents watching the show?
So they get it delayed. So they get it a day after we do. And I definitely
wait. Damn. All right, I hate to be real ghetto right now.
What happened?
Okay, I reached my goal weight, so I owe myself a cauliflower pizza, and it's at the door. I gotta pay for it. I'll be right back.
Oh, let me see you walk away. Let me see you walk away. Go ahead.
That's a, look at you, skinny. That's
some. Yes,
that's 150 pounds less right there.
That is some hippy dippy shit. Cauliflower pizza. What the fuck does that mean?
And not just cauliflower. It's at the door. It's delivered. Nigga, who delivers cauliflower?
It's not delivery. It's not DiGiorno. It's delivery.
But he in the country. Like,
in upstate New York, they'll even put cauliflower on a goddamn pizza.
But yo, cauliflower rice from Trader
Joe's.
Oh, sure.
From Target? Sure. Wait, the Target or the Trader Joe's?
No.
Joe's, cuz. That TJ's, cuz.
And it's crunchy? You just need to put a little adobo on that joint.
Yeah, you sauce it up a little bit.
I've been trying to get Jason to make the change with me. So
yo, it'll bless your life. I ain't gonna front. That cauliflower rice.
It's not gonna make you walk away from old rice completely.
Hey,
but it's a good setup. Like, it's a good kind of, you know, it's a good substitute.
I'm not mad at it. You just dice up some chicken sausage next to it, brother.
Yes, talk.
Man, I do it with some fish. Do a little stir fry.
Baby got his stitches out.
The shrimp burger from Trader Joe's.
Oh, no. The shrimp had... let's not get into a Trader Joe's conversation. You in the wrong show, because we can go
let's
in.
Let's get into a Trader Joe's conversation.
All right, let's
I
go.
Think we're there.
Okay.
I think we're there.
We are there. Okay.
The shrimp burger is actually pretty good. My wife got one. I think I threw one on the grill. I smoked it with some hickory wood. And
Add some avocado on that joint.
You just like that. Country as fuck. I smoked the salmon burger on the grill. Shut up. That was awesome.
No lie, we did that to crab legs the other night when we put it on the grill.
Wait, you're in California?
I am.
Yeah.
Okay, and you too, Laiya?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm always weird on where you get your crab legs.
I'm Hollywood, between Hollywood and Duarte. We like, yeah.
Okay.
All right, but I'm just... No, I just wanted to know, can crabs be trusted in L.A.?
Oh, crab legs.
Crabs are shipped from Baltimore to L.A. I went to a crab boil, and they shipped it from Baltimore.
Sometimes, but Yvonne, talk about those crab places in L.A. that you go and get the bags.
In the bag!
I've never been to one out there. Are they good? They official?
You got something too. They put.
You got the corn in the cob. You got
more
the sausage,
official than the boil the whole, in New York City.
Yeah.
But the crabs be puny.
No. Oh, yeah, okay. I do the king crab legs. You got turn up, and then
gotta be down with the king.
You got my dude.
There's some HBO checks coming in.
Hey, God bless it. Mama, I'm
doing
made
like $30 a cluster.
But y'all hear my theme song? Y'all know I created that theme song when I created it. But somebody, this artist named Midlo, she wrote it.
That's when you said that, because when dope. You came out, I was like, oh, damn, it's like a real concert. Like, she came out doing the Auntie Mary dance. I thought he was about to bust a verse. And then there was some edit there. I was like, did you perform that song? Or
they had the song Glaring, and then I was doing it like I was the rapper. I'm not the rapper.
I was wondering who did that theme. Okay.
But
okay.
I told HBO, I was like, I want to do a documentary music video comedy special. They were like, nigga, what? I was like, properly.
In Nigeria. That's clear. In Nigeria, on top of that.
I was going to say, probably, are you considering doing something back at home, performance-wise? Like,
how hard would that be?
Part of it, so in the special where you see me with the green and there's a crowd, like I actually did like a comedy show and a talk back and a Q&A in Vegas. And so they didn't, like, they just added that, just like a little bit of the clip, but.
So everyone in the Q&A mm-hmm. at so that I'm spot, that's okay. Okay.
Yeah. But so the book's coming out, and that is basically me paralleling my journey with like other people in the Bible. Cause you know, I'm in my 30s and I'm like, yo, but Jesus is dope. And that's apparently not a thing that you hear most young people, because it's like people find God like at 80. And
not in Corona world, not in Rome.
You right there. God later. And I'm just was like, yo, I feel like there's so many dope parallels of different people and who've had journeys that God was like, hey, do this thing. And they were like, what? And so that's what the book is. The book is taking my journey and then like interweaving it with like Joseph or with Gideon or, you know, and just making it making it relevant again.
Lot's wife. Why you? Why you mind your own damn business? If you just would have kept looking ahead, you'd have been all right. But you would have turned your nose ass around.
Wait a minute. Yeah. That reminds me. I don't know what film that I saw where they depicted Lot's wife, but she literally turned into salt as she was talking, like melting away.
Oh, I forget. Wow. I got it. I want to see someone redo the story of Samson and Delilah. Samson and Delilah, and like Samson get a number two fade. So
cute. I'm about to say that Molly. So what's his name on
Insecure?
Your boyfriend on Insecure.
Nathan?
Why did he cut his hair?
Oh no! The Asian guy, the Asian dude. Homie.
Why did he cut his hair?
So first of all, he didn't know he was coming back.
Oh,
and so he had another job.
Yeah, he got booked.
Yeah, he had another job, and he was like, here we go. Go and take this. And then they were like, by the way, you're gonna be a series regular on this joint. He was like, oh, well then here we go. But it's cool. That's why we mentioned it. So if you notice the first episode, we kind of just did a jab on it. I was like, did you lose all your power after you cut your hair?
I love him. I love his character.
He's also Australian. It's so funny. Black people be like, they hear an accent, they're like, he's British. And I'm like, nah, nigga, that's not the only accent that exists in life.
We know. You ain't got to put us in a box like that.
The man is Australian. They're like, oh, I love his British accent. I was like,
British accent. I didn't know chocolate he was real girlfriend, if she's still around. Yeah.
Yeah, he is really dating a Ghanaian girl from PG County. I was like, so clearly you have a type, my nigga.
Wow.
No, P.S. Can we talk about the PG County DC reference 2 episodes ago and how they disrespected our whole legacy? Okay. Can we talk about
I took my headphones.
Rhoda.
We're talking about
there's a young girl. So you know, every season we do the Insecure on set PA contest.
Right. So
two young black girls from Howard won. One of them is Kenzie, and Kenzie's from PG County. And she, from being a PA, she then got to be in the writer's room like last season. Exactly. Issa is just so dope. I told her, I was like, your vision has birthed so many dreams.
That is so dope. I remember I've had a couple girlfriends that be like, yeah, we should apply for that.
Yes. And so that's where that line that she's responsible for that line. Everyone thinks like they were like, nigga, was that you? I was like, I respected the line. I appreciate the nod to PG County, but Kenzie definitely was the foundation for that.
I really love the joke y'all did at the end of the scene,
the song
where y'all are fighting. Oh my God. the nod to the Mary Hillary Clinton. Is it a gun? Is it a knife? Dude, I had it on my stories like a couple of days ago. Oh my God. But yeah, because they're about to fight. This is my life. Is it a gun? Is it a knife? Nigga, that shit was funny as fuck. I'm like, yo. I like that. Y'all have y'all little, and I love too the show within shows.
Yeah.
Like me and Prentice, like Prentice will talk like on Twitter, like we'll shoot and shit with a dude. The show within the shows, that be look, man, I hate slavery. Nigga,
I hate slavery. It's they're so ridiculous and they're so outlandish that we're just like, let's go with
go
it.
Go with it.
And this year, niggas is really looking for Latoya. They're like, but where is
for
she?
For real. Yo, I'm so mad at that with SZA. Wait, I'm sorry. I shouldn't say anything.
What happened? Oh,
nothing. Anyway.
Speaking code.
Uh-oh.
No spoilers.
But I love him here, put his foot in his mouth.
Okay. So we, okay. I think I see what he's, okay. I get it. I won't go.
Right.
But yeah, Ray J, I thought the casting of Ray J was great.
That was awesome.
Yeah. And just for the record, somebody wanted me to make sure to get your opinion, your parking space or Issa's parking space. Just come on, just make it official.
So here's the thing. And you know, I can't speak for Molly, but, or maybe I can, I don't know. But if you go past the spot, and you don't have the blinker that's saying that you reverse. Oh. Like, if you don't put it in reverse, how do I know that that's your spot?
But don't nobody pull into that kind of small spot. Okay, we're not going. All right.
Well, you wouldn't stop before the spot. You wouldn't stop and not go in the spot. Why would you stop there?
You have to stop at the top of the spot to back in the spot.
To back it in, to angle it in.
Right. Or do you go ahead, head in first, or do you back in? Like,
I back in. We're still talking about the spot.
Absolutely.
Thanks,
you ain't backing in nowhere else.
Either way.
Want to make sure that I'm not putting myself in soundbite. Just like, so do you back in? Nigga, what are we talking about?
Backing in an orgies, I don't know.
So, yeah, I mean, obviously, yes. Technically, it was Issa's spot. I don't know if Issa was quick with, because, you know, she was still listening to Michelle Obama. She was trying to become. So she may have just been may have just been not paying attention, and Molly pulled up quick to retrieve it. You know, that's what Sir Mix-a-Lot said. I pulled up quick to retrieve it. So
oh, that's a cool free ass.
Yo, so who are you personally on, Yvonne? Are you Team Molly or Team Issa?
Yes,
like outside of your character. I mean, you know,
what is Yvonne? Yes,
I'm Team Gross. You know, I think that's just where we all need to be. I'm actually Team Daniel. Where is that nigga? Because these girls, I'm like, let them get their lives together. No, it's so funny because I've been having conversations all week because it's interesting how people feel about these characters, because I think it's a direct reflection of how they feel about themselves.
Oh, absolutely. Man. That's what TV is.
Oh, they take it, but no, Insecure, they take it real personal. Go ahead.
We have men on the show, so it's really interesting. I'd love to get your opinion, because so many of the comments are, Molly don't deserve Andrew. No, like, he's patient and he's kind. Like, she don't deserve him. And it's just like, so wait. As black women, should we not get a nice man?
right.
We not deserve to have love unless we show up as perfect? Like, what does that really say about relationships and who
we're just waiting for him to lose his patience a little bit, though, because after what you did this past week, I was like, I'm going to need him to
headphones out.
But I thought it. Oh, okay. Yeah. No.
Stop,
but
spoiler alert.
He's taking his. He's taking his headphones out to spoil.
Yeah, but I knew you like it. So
I didn't say anything.
But I okay. So to without spoiling it for Amir, to your point, Laiya, I thought that what she was showing in that episode, yeah, she was kind of wilding, but the call that you made at the end, was signifying that she recognized that, okay, something is off. For me, watching it as watching the show as a man, and I tell my wife about this, I think the most eye-opening thing for me for this particular season, that I like what y'all are doing, is that it's really kind of giving us men a fly on the wall view of interpersonal female relationships and how they break down. Because every man, like all my homies, like we've all had that moment with, you know, your girl or somebody you dating or whatever, where you have to sit down with her and it's like they'll tell you something. Let me tell you what happened, and they'll tell you a story, and you'll be like, baby, you know you kind of the problem, right? You know what I mean? like you know that was on you. And so it to me
this are you allowed to say that though?
Hell yeah.
You should be if it's a good relationship.
Yeah, because the thing is, like, it's this season, what I'm seeing is like, you know, again, just from the male side, we see like women like fall out and stuff. We be like, yo, like, wasn't she your girl? Like, what the fuck happened? And even the way y'all are showing it with Andrew, he's totally oblivious to the shit that was going on with them. He was like, yo, I helped her out. I thought that was your girl.
He should have definitely been like, BT Dubs, my nigga. That should have been a BT Dubs moment. Like, we about to go over here. I just want to let you know, like, this is what I did. Not like, I need your permission, but just like, heads up.
But he wouldn't.
But I could see as a man, we wasn't even thinking. Yeah, we're not even thinking that.
If you didn't have a conversation with her first, now he got to read our mind.
Yeah, right. Now I got, yeah. So it's given like just all the little things that kind of can break down, I guess, mm-hmm. you know, female companionship. I think y'all are doing a really good job of detailing that.
However, I do have to remind my girlfriends that these girls are in their early, early 30s. Yeah.
But let's be clear, because my friend, shout out my homegirl Carmen Rogers, she brought this up, because when I brought that same point, 30s now is not the same as 30s, you know, younger, 10 right? years ago, yeah. 15 years mean? Ago. It's much younger. It's much younger.
What it felt like.
If you ever look at pictures of old niggas back in the day, like if you look at a picture of Otis Redding, that nigga was 26.
How was that he 28?
Bro, he wasn't even 30. That man looked like he worked a full
Why is looking at old 27. Pictures of Otis Redding?
I thought he was 47.
Look, everyone has their kinks, Unpaid Bill. Don't shame me. But nah, if you look at pictures of like old, like if like I saw Otis a picture. Redding. Yeah, like
to be like looking in your album and you're like, oh, there's Otis Redding.
Steve right now is 26. Steve is 26.
Steve is 108.
but to your point too, it's like it doesn't actually matter if they are early 30s. Whatever you don't fix in your 30s, you take to your 40s.
It shows and up.
It shows up. And I think it's important because that's why I'm so interested, because, you know, our fan base is like from 20 something to 40 something and even a little beyond. And it's funny because it's just like, is this how y'all handle situations now? Like,
yes, Yvonne, that is how they
handle situations. Fight, like,
have
no,
you,
seriously.
Have you seen Instagram lately?
No.
Have you seen Twitter?
Like, seriously, one of my best girlfriends called me, like, she really about to fight her best friend? Like, that's crazy. I'm like, that's TV, and that's not us.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I don't think it applies to everybody. Like, literally about to fist fight over something where she didn't even touch you. I mean, that's real young.
Except if you watch some of these real House of Stuffs, you know?
Real House of Stuffs.
I think guys, it's kind of like the blessing and the curse, because sometimes guys need to use more words. Like y'all need to use all your words. But then sometimes y'all can literally have a whole beef with a dude, like, I can't stand that nigga, real talk, blah, 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 blah. But then y'all get on the basketball court, and then it's like, oh, yeah, no, we good. Nah, we talked it out. How did you talk it out? Now, you know, he was able to get that rebound.
We played. Yo, that's
nonverbal communication.
Our bonds. Yeah, we form, I think women form bonds by, like, talking. Men form bonds by doing. So if I see how you play your game, if we're on the basketball court, hell, if we playing 2K on damn PlayStation, that's telling me about you as a man. You know what I'm saying? That's showing me your metal. You know what I mean?
Problematic. That is a problematic.
How is it problematic? If that's showing me, listen, I know if I throw this alley-oop, nigga, if you miss this, if you don't catch it, nigga, you ain't shit. And you ain't invited. But if you catch it, shit, nigga, we rocking. I can count on you when shit get real. Listen, you got this that is bill? How we do it.
That's how
Anytime Phonte give a message, I gotta make sure.
I'm gonna write that down. But next to Joe Budden and auto pay. I'm good.
I want
to
see what your male friendships are like. I want to
yeah,
see.
Yeah,
my male friendships are fucking wonderful because we accept each other as who we are, and
y'all sing about them.
For male friendships, is like it's different. So I think for us, they change kind of as you get age, which I'm sure, I mean, female friendships are the same way. But for male, for men, it's like in your 20s, you kind of see your peers as competition. And so it's like, you're just like, yo, I got to see this nigga. I got to do this. I got to do that. Like, you see them as competition. Your 30s, you start to see your peers as collaborators, because that's kind of when you start to find your tribe and see, okay, we're like-minded. Mm-hmm. By the time you get to your 40s, as a black man, 40 and on, you just see your peers as survivors, nigga. Like, you just look at niggas. It's like, nigga, you know what? We might have had problems. I may not have liked what you did or music you made, whatever. But if you made it this far and you still standing, nigga, you made it. And I salute that. And you find your commonality in that. You look at each other as people who have a shared experience and people who have survived all the foolishness, and niggas are still here. So there's a mutual respect that is there.
But can I ask, this is a real question. I grew up with three older brothers, so I'm fascinated by like men and black men specifically. But what is it about it when I ask a dude, like, yo, if I meet a good dude, like, loves his girl, loves his family, does the work, whatever, and I'm like, yo, where are your boys? Where are your friends like you? And they're like, yeah, nah, I don't want none of my friends. And it's like,
Mason too, yeah.
How are you the only good
nigga? I think these are my only friends right now. No,
that's a good question, though.
I don't think it's that he's the only good nigga. Like, he's the only good one. He may be the only available one.
Nah, you know it's saying? The only good. This nigga's like, I'm telling you, you don't.
It's both.
And then, so my question is, why do you rock with them if you know that they are trash niggas? And it's just like,
that's what I'm saying. They're not. He ain't the only good one. That's kind of what I'm communicating. Like, nigga, if you hang around in the barbershop all day, eventually you're going to get a haircut. If you hang around with them wild niggas.
Wow.
Like, there's something that's you amazing. Had to do. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's something you had to do to prove your mettle. Like, it ain't going to be, okay, I go to Harvard Law School, but the rest of my homies is bloods. You know what I mean? Like, nigga, no.
Wait,
like,
you acknowledge point in time. Can we acknowledge that? I think that was Phonte's idiom for 2020. Yeah. You hang around a barbershop
long enough, you're going to get a haircut. Yvonne got to Phonte. Here we go. Go ahead, Phonte. What's your man relationships
Yvonne,
like?
Yvonne, you're asking. Get into it. You're asking the good guys, you know, like, why are they always the
good guys?
The black sheep of their squad.
Good
guys. No, I'm saying, like, if I got a man and you are like, yo, I mean, you mad cool. Where are your homegirls that are like you? I'm like, nigga, Rolodex. What you like?
How oh,
you like?
Yeah.
I like them.
You know, so
that's
like,
some
different.
Black woman stuff
it's
right
different.
There.
It's different. When women is different, I'm fortunate enough. Okay, now that I'm getting older, I'm meeting, or maybe it's Grace's friends. Like, she strives to meet people that are on her level. Like, all of her friends are just like killing it right now. No one's a threat to each other.
That's Amir's girlfriend, Yvonne.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry. But then I also know people that kind of want to be the shark in the goldfish tank. You know what I mean? That want to be the star of it.
They want to be the apex predator. Yeah, the kind of the top of the food.
Right.
Gotcha.
Exactly. And I don't know. With dudes sometimes, I mean, me personally, I have to hang around motherfuckers way smarter than me.
Do you have dope single friends?
Me?
Yes. That you will hook up.
Yo, that's what we're saying. It's like,
you guys are divorced. Or
can I get a
you're
Steve? Can I get
married
a Steve?
Again?
Steve
Wait,
have dope
you're friends? Married again. No.
It's a numbers game. Like, so Yvonne, when you were saying, like, you have a Rolodex of, like, if someone meets you and was like, oh, I like you, friends like you, you got a bunch of homegirls you could turn them on to that are single and available. For us, if you meet me and you say, yo, I really like you, where's the guys like you? I'm like, them niggas is married on their third kid right now. Like, it's over. Like, you should have caught them niggas in their 20s.
Damn, that sounds sad.
So that's it. But I'm not getting that they're married. And
wait, are we supposed to hook you up? Are we hooking you up with?
No. This is.
And Lai's like waiting in line.
This is literally just about in terms of like friendships. Like most female friend circles are like minded, right? You may have that one outlier that's like she the life of the party, so we let her in. But for the most part, if everybody went to Stanford, most of the people you're going to be around, like, are college educated, they're driven, et cetera. If they're, you know, saying, but you will meet like a dope college educated dude and who uses his words or whatever. And it's just like, yeah, nah. You know, but these are just my friends that I've known since I was 13. So that's why they're still my best friends. But it's just like, so wait, how are you the smartest one in your whole circle? Like, huh? Or why are you the whatever
the kind of the anomaly of everyone else? Yo, it's loyalty. I think a lot of it is loyalty. And too, with guys, for us, you know, it's trust. So, you know, like, I mean, shit, look at LeBron James, you know what I mean? Like, he still got his day ones is with him from there. Mm-hmm. So for us, it's a big thing of even though we may have gone to different paths, like, mm-hmm, I may have gone to Stanford, wherever the fuck, and y'all stayed home or got married or whatever the hell y'all did. You know what I'm saying? Y'all are still the core and the crew that knew me before all this shit. So I know that y'all are around me for the right reasons. Now, so that can
do you
change.
Rock with your day ones?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm now, and I ain't got but probably about a handful of them, but hell,
that's
yeah.
Enough. Day ones, God, no. But then who sharpens you? Because, you know, iron sharpens iron. So who sharpens you?
I'm being sharpened right now. Questlove Supreme, Yvonne Orji. I mean, I have conversations. Me and Laiya, we had a great conversation just via text earlier. You know, just the people I meet just in the game, I look at everybody as a potential lesson. And I look at what they have to offer. And it's like, you know, even if they're on a different social level or whatever, like, I don't give a fuck about that. There's something in the world that they've seen that I haven't. And they have a perspective that could be useful to me. So I like that.
I'm probably the one that every 10 years I notice that I sort of shave off and do some spring cleaning and sort of rise up to the next level of where I need to get in life as far as my friendships are concerned. And not even like in a business sense, but just like people that keep me sharp and that sort of thing. So
sometimes that happens. You got some day ones around?
Huh?
You got some day ones around? Just in case.
I mean, Tariq is my day, you know.
That's true.
But it's weird. It, you know, like, do I have anyone in my life with me that I don't, just because of the nature of how I work? You know, I think you also have space in your life really for like maybe 30 people, 30 like close people. So, you know, do I have someone in my life that's not directly like related to, like, do I still hang with Sean Riley next door to my grandmom's house that we used to play basketball together? No, but you know, yeah, I guess I'm still with my day ones. I just built a business with them.
Thank you, bottom facts. Because the thing is, you have to do, you have to look at it like, and let me be clear, like, Yvonne, like, we talk about this. Yeah, there's loyalty, but there's also loyalty to a fault. So my thing is, I'm loyal up until the point where you become a liability. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. So, second you liability, me? I got to be out.
Yeah, like, because now it's like, nigga, you about to fuck all my shit up. I don't work too goddamn hard. Like, nah, it, fuck all that. But, yeah, I mean, you have homies that are just in different stations of life, and I could be clear. Like, if you came to me and was like, yo, I like you. Where's some homies like you? I'm like, yo, all my homies is, you know, they occupied. that's what
that
it is.
Amazing.
Well, how nice is it that we can have a conversation to take our minds off of this week?
We need it.
how are you doing out in L.A.? I'm hearing L.A. is acting up a little right now.
I've been home. I've really been inside. But yesterday was definitely me texting all the black men in my life. Like, I see you. I respect you. This That's world amazing. May not, but I mean, literally, that was I hit a rail. I was like, I just want you to know, I see you, black man. Like, and it's just so, it's like crazy that we have to, but it's crazy because, you know, obviously with my background in health, I was just like, bruh, how can we have the Hippocratic Oath for doctors? And it's just like, if you mess that up, if you mess up someone's life as physician, you can no longer practice. I'm sorry. You got to go to another country, bro, because in America, it's not possible. And they work with scalpels.
Right.
What is the Hippocratic? And I don't know. I don't know the law enforcement system. I don't know if they
the code of blue don't
because
have nothing to do with us.
The process of becoming law enforcement is not that of the medical world. Like, you can be a high school dropout and be law enforcement, and 9 times out of 10, you know.
The process is one thing, but I also, but the code is another. Like, process is different, but like, you have to, the oath of like, hey, if you do something to jeopardize, to go against protecting and serving, how about that? Right. That is your code, mm-hmm. to protect and serve. If you do anything to jeopardize that, it jeopardizes your livelihood. It jeopardizes your career trajectory.
Right.
But that hasn't been the case. And I think that is...
Because at the end of the day, I mean, the police organizations were started during Jim Crow periods to really keep their eyes on free slaves who they were afraid were going to have an uprising, you know, during the, what's the period, the Reconstruction period.
Yeah,
the Reconstruction period. And that's, I mean, that's the seed and the genesis of the idea of policing. And
overseer officer.
Yeah, and until I know we're like, oh God, you know, we need to address and have a conversation, but you know,
but that
that's the real conversation that needs to be had.
Yeah, I mean, even if there is not an oath, as a, there needs to be an instituted one, right? It's like, again, I say a doctor cannot practice if they mess up someone's life. How are you still able to carry a gun? And
I would prefer for non-white supremacists to be in this profession, but
right, that part.
You know, who's gonna?
And what's sad is I feel like, you know how like when Corona hit, it a lot of black people didn't take it seriously until they canceled the NBA. And it's like, wait, what? Like, no, this serious. Right. LeBron is at home. Whatever that needs. We need whatever that is. And I don't know, like, I mean, it's like...
You mean for white people or for black people, we need whatever that is? Like, because...
Yeah, the country as a whole needs whatever that is.
The country as a whole,
To be like, wait, ah, dang. Like, it's almost like... It's almost like the black relative of a very famous white person. And then it's like, you know what I mean? Like, whatever the, again, it's almost like, what? Like, the uprising has to come when it's like,
it might be, but you know what? I'm watching this mayor in Minnesota, and I'm liking the way that he moves in the sense that he is pissed and he wants blood. And this is the first.
Yeah, no, the chief, the police chief, I think, and the Minneapolis is like, now this is ridiculous.
And the white mayor, and we all know it makes a difference when a white man speaks up, which is wrong, but it makes a difference when a white man speaks up. So when this white mayor says, yo, I want blood, and if this was because this was a black man, that this man is dead, and if I was that officer, if you were that officer, we would all be arrested. He needs to be arrested. That's a big deal. I was like, let's not sleep on a little small
thing. But also, it's also kind of like, bro, you had your hand in your pocket. Like, you weren't even trying to arrest
him. Like, on your hip, like, you was like, what? What?
Like, what do we do? Like, at that point, it's just like, this one even, this, there's no way to like, but what, there's actually no way to skirt around. Right.
But we said that in the past.
This is really black or white. There's no gray area in this shit.
They've always found the gray.
But I really do think that when America wakes up is when it's just like, what do you mean? Celebrity X's, you know, daughter who was adopted or whatever. Like, what do you, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, what do you mean?
Yeah, who is the important black body that's going...
I don't know. I think this country, you know, I mean, I agree with y'all. I mean, I would love to see that. I just think
which
this country
so sad.
Was
important
born in
black
violence.
Body. That I'm like, right. You said
as opposed
body.
To an unimportant one. Right.
But exactly. But again, the NBA, important black sport. You know, canceled the season. Corona is a serious threat. You know, it's like, what is that thing?
I don't know. I thought Sandy Hook would have been that thing, which is not a police retreat, but you know, it's something that
people got over Sandy Hook in a month, 9/11 like, you know, in a month, Orlando in a month,
Corona in two.
right.
Hey,
them
facts.
Motherfuckers just like, yo, we going back out. Just
they were like, yo, I ain't seen a shape up in 2 months. I gotta get out.
I mean, I know I ain't been tested and it ain't no cure, but it's good, right? It's been 2 months.
Fuck it. It's over. We ready to go out.
I ain't called since December.
Oh, have y'all been seeing the whole, I think I had it before? Have y'all been seeing a lot of people? But I think I had Corona back in November. Remember I was sick them days?
A lot of people are saying that.
I got to be honest with you.
You think you had the Rona?
Maybe we had it in January. Now our immune system is just super strong right now. And
no, I was at Sundance, and my friend who was at Sundance with me, she was like, yo, I'm convinced I had Corona. Because she had this cold that was lingering. And I was like, you good? And she's like, I got to sit down. And I believe her.
Are you guys going to
Sundance? I heard that. I heard Sundance was,
I was at Sundance. I probably had it.
Hey. Are you going? Wait, I'm sorry, it just hit me. Wait, I'm sorry. This might be.
You about to ask about Sundance? Because I don't think it's gonna be. Coachella said they looking at next week. Yeah. Next summer.
Next summer, like 2021.
Yeah, they off of October.
Mm-hmm. Oh well, yes, I knew they was off October. In February, but okay.
You were so lucky.
I'm sorry, Amir.
Know why they go this year. This is crazy.
It was over, dude. It's a wrap. Like, when them niggas, look, man, when them, again, like, for you, I think, like you said, Yvonne, the NBA was, like, the thing for black people. For me, it was Coachella. Well, first it was South by Southwest, but then Coachella. Like, when they canceled it, I said, dude, it's over. It's a wrap. 2020 is done.
It is over. It is over.
Of course, what were you about to say? I mean,
I got distracted because... No, I got distracted only because, you know, the woman in the wheelchair in the Target.
Nigga, let me tell you.
No,
the hashtags. Yo, at one point, the entire, like, four of them hashtags was just, she's 30. She can walk. She had a knife. I couldn't even explain to Grace why I was dying on the floor today, because it was just something you had to have seen in real time. But
this is the woman that got the extinguisher, the fire extinguisher.
Yes, yes.
But she not disabled?
Yvonne, she can walk.
They attacked a woman in a wheelchair. Walk.
Nigga, listen. Look, man.
So the headline, this woman. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
George Floyd tracks woman. Yeah. Protesters. So the thing was, she was by the Target, I guess, by the door.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And people are like running in out of Target. And so I have a Snapchat a snippet of people screaming and looking at her, and they're like, She's stabbing people. The lady was stabbing people. So that was why another homie went and grabbed a fire extinguisher and goddamn doused that ass. That laid it out real good on her. Yeah. And so then there's another clip of her getting up out of the wheelchair. Up,
running.
Yeah. Yvonne Orji, let me just say, if you want to be stay in tune to all the happenings and mishappenings on Black Twitter, follow me at Fontigolo on Twitter.
Yeah, you might as well. Yeah.
Prentice is there. Issa's there. Like, we all family. Holler at me.
Consider it finished.
Hey, Dowster.
Okay. No, Laiya, it's a lie, yo. It's everything's a lie. She's 30 years old. She can walk.
So why would you go through the trouble of putting on a wig, like making yourself look older? This is a problem. This is when everybody
this is beyond Karen in the park. This is like next level.
This is the Oscar goes too. Because this is some. Why do you feel like you needed to do all of that in order to get sympathy? In order to do the trash thing you were gonna do, like
when you're already white, like you had the cover, trust me,
you had the job already.
Yeah, you didn't need a wheelchair.
White ladies in the bar, because I'm telling
you. No, did you? I'm sure you already talked about Karen in the park when she hyped herself up and was like, as an actress, I was like, nigga, that's
method.
Wow, like nobody's coming at. I said, she has been practicing this. Oh, wait. Nigga, I was taking notes. I was like, hey,
Yvonne, of course she's been practicing it. She's got it from generations. These ladies been doing this for generations. We just got a phone on them.
Like, if there is a glory tear that gets shed, nigga, I'm giving her the award. I was looking. Because he was double social distancing. He was more than 6 feet away from her.
Yeah, he was way back. He was way back, yeah.
and she was like, hey, you're not coming. I said, whoa, what up? Nigga, I got scared. I said, ma'am, nigga, let me put my phone down.
Yeah.
That is top tier.
That shit was my worst nightmare.
Like, that was some top tier white womaning, I must say.
And that was just white womaning. This week alone. So,
red label.
Yvonne, we have to wrap up this episode before it turns into a real episode of Questlove Supreme. I'm almost certain it's about to be.
When he say real, he mean that the audio versions we do of this joint, it be like 2 hours at the least, and you don't want none of that.
Copy. Well, thanks for having me, guys.
We love you and thank you so much. Girl. And we appreciate your work and we love everything you do.
Nah, the shit is funny. Like, I like big ups on the comedy special. Like, the shit is hilarious, and I hope you get all your flowers and more work on the strength of that. The shit is hilarious.
I appreciate that, because you seem like a real black nigga. Like, you seem like the nigga.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'm. I'm totally. I'm completely problematic. So just now.
He loved it. He hit us at 2 a.m. Like, watch this shit now.
You know how, like, you can receive certain from certain people, like, you know, like your friends, you're just like, oh, it was great. Like, no, I mean, what I liked about it was the beginning. I really like. Yeah.
The beginning.
You see, y'all, this group of folks feels like the kind that be like, no, we're not going to have that on. We can't buy that.
No, they are hard. They are hard to please.
Hold me?
They are hard to please.
Hold me.
The hold me. I love that.
I appreciate y'all.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Unpaid Bill.
Otis Redding.
Look at Steve. Steve, I'm proud of you, bro. You... Damn, Steve got off immediately.
He's playing the music, though. He there.
Oh. Yeah, he got to do his thing.
Hey, don't forget, while we're playing the outro music, don't forget to check out Yvonne Orji's comedy special. It debuts when, Yvonne?
June 6th on HBO Max, 10 p.m.
Also, don't forget, next Monday, we start Black Music Month, and Questlove Supreme is doing it with Deanna Williams on Monday, and a new episode with Kimmy Gamble on Wednesday. Yep. We black.
Bang, bang.
I'll see y'all later. All right.
All right, y'all. Thank peace, Yvonne. Y'all be good. Bye-bye.